Revelation 4, find verse 2 with me. While you're finding your place there, let me remind you of a couple of things going on. One, if you would like to make a contribution to support our IMB, our International Mission Board missionaries, who are in the countries surrounding the Ukraine that are receiving the refugees, just giving support and relief to the refugee crisis right now, specifically in Poland, you can do so by donating on the app or on the website. Just select the love offering option, and that'll go toward the IMB's effort there in the refugee crisis. Also, if you are interested in our Footsteps of Paul tour of Greece, you can sign up for that at fbfirst.com. We have 57 so far signed up for that. And every day, it seems, a few more come in. It will hit a point where we'll have to cut off the sign-ups, but hopefully we've got a little ways to go on that. If you would like to go with us, it's going to be a fantastic trip. Five-star accommodations, some amazing food and scenery. So check that out at fbfirst.com. Journalist Molly Longman captures a sentiment that I'm hearing quite frequently as I talk to people in our own area and around the world. She writes, "I joked to a friend in 2022 that this could be the year that I finally had an existential crisis. Just kidding," she said, "kind of. My worries, of course, could have been much worse. I was safe, employed, sheltered, but I still felt a kind of sense of mounting dread, a sense that everything could disappear in a moment. And if it did, what would I have then? My thoughts circled my work, my relationships. Had I accomplished enough? Should I be using my platform as a writer to do more? Was I spending enough time in my life with the people that I cared about? Was my purpose to shine a light on injustice as I had thought it was? And was I even capable of doing that? Or was I simply wasting away hunched over my laptop? Should I use my time on this unstable planet to cultivate my friendships, memorize my parents' laughs, find the best cupcake shop in New York? What if one day I wake up 10 years from now and I'm totally unhappy?" When I shared my spiraling thoughts with my friends, many related. We all seem to be in a similar funk, questioning our existence, our careers, and our relationships. That's a sentiment I'm hearing quite often, especially among young people in our day and time. A confusion, a emotional and spiritual funk, as it were, that doesn't know what to make out of this crazy world that we find ourselves in. Post-COVID, as we are hearing of wars and rumors of wars, questioning our existence, our purpose, not totally unlike probably the emotional state of John the Apostle here on the Isle of Patmos. He had watched the churches that he had given his life for began to slip into apostasy, anarchy, and rebellion. An ocean separated him from his family, his friends, his loved ones. No doubt he was asking some of the same questions that we ask in days like these, and that's when it happened. Look with me at chapter 4, verse 2. "At once I was in the Spirit." Now, John begins by reminding us that this is a vision that he's going to describe for us. A vision is like watching while you're awake, eyes wide open, watching scenes from a strange movie unfold before your face, with every scene packed with meaning, every image packed with meaning. His body never leaves Patmos. He's not asleep. That would be a dream. A dream while you are awake is a vision. The things that he's about to see are highly symbolic, and they should be read that way. For example, we're going to read in this text that he sees Jesus as a lamb standing, though slain, with seven horns and seven eyes. When you meet Jesus in heaven, don't ask him where his other five eyes are. Jesus doesn't literally morph into an animal. Jesus doesn't literally have seven eyes. These are symbolic representation of a concrete reality. So he's unfolding, he's describing in his own words the vision that God gives him of the revelation of Jesus Christ. I thought to myself, how could I explain this to you in a way that you would grasp? And I thought, what if I had to describe Amelia Island with the language of a vision? And it may go like this. Behold, out of the Atlantic rose a great sea turtle, one fin upon its mother and another upon its sister. It's the two bridges. Out of its shell rose two teeth of a megalodon, with smaller teeth proceeding behind it. That's the Omni, the Ritz, and all the other businesses of our island. The teeth sought to rise up, but they could not, for the great beast from the abyss rose up to strike them down. City Hall. So, something like that is what's going on here. John is seeing these things. He's describing them. Some of them he may not have fully understood. You say, well, when I read Revelation, I'm not always sure what's going on. I'm not sure John understood what all was going on. But he did see these things. They are packed with meaning. And he did relate them onto us. And so as we read, you say, well, why would God communicate that way? There's several different reasons. Some of it is that it's veiled in mystery, and some of these things you won't know until you're on top of it. Also, because he's inviting you to bring your imagination to the table. So today, as we sit in church on the Lord's Day, he wants you not to go on cruise control and just listen. He wants you to engage your imagination with the text. He's describing things. And he wants you to try to imagine them. So let's do that together as we read through the text. I'm going to give you some things to help you with the words and the symbols you may not understand, but you have to bring your creativity to the table. Chapter 4 begins to set the scene for the drama that unfolds in chapter 5. Look at how he says it. He says, "At once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian." So jasper and carnelian are the two red stones to your right. You see here, they're reddish in appearance in their purest form. And so whoever was sitting upon the throne, we find out later is God, the Ancient of Days, Jehovah, had this appearance. It was red in appearance. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. That's green. So imagine a rainbow just made up of shades of green around this throne. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with golden crowns upon their head. We don't know who these 24 elders are. Some have suggested they were angels, could be. Some have suggested that they were church leaders from the past 2,000 years, could be. Some have suggested there were 12 of the Old Testament tribes, the representatives of the tribes of Israel. Some have suggested that then there were 12 more of the apostles of the Lamb, could be. We don't know. John doesn't tell us. In verse 5, "From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God." So this is reminiscent of the scene that Israel beheld as it stood before, camped in front of Mount Sinai. Moses went up on the mountain. The mountain rumbling, flames of fire, peals of thunder, and flashes of lightning. Verse 6, "And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with a face like a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them had six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come.' And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated upon the throne, who lives forever and forever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne, and they worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. So this is a vision of the judgment throne of God, the hall of his glory. You see here an artist's depiction of what this one person envisioned it looking like, perhaps. If you were to walk into the literal judgment room of God today, it's highly unlikely it would look just like this. These are symbolic images that are describing what God wanted to convey to John and through John to you. In verse 5, "Then I saw in the right hand of him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals." The scroll typically would unfold to about 30 feet in length. Most scrolls would be written on the inside so that when it is rolled up, it would conceal the contents. This scroll, however, is written on the inside and on the outside. There was a lot to say, but also he's showing that some of what is written on the scroll has already been revealed. You already know these things. They've been spoken of in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. And so some of this is not new information. Other parts of it are new information. You've not known these things before. So it's written on both sides. The scroll contains the unfolding plan of God to set right all that has gone wrong on planet Earth. Now, there is a sense in which that's what the whole Bible is about. In the beginning, God creates the heaven and the earth. He plants man. He makes him of the dust of the ground. He takes woman out of the man. He sets them in paradise. Can you imagine what their marriage was like? Can you imagine the oneness that they had? Just everything. Every meal they ever ate was a feast. It was a pleasure. Walking with God in the cool of the day, they worked. They were placed in the garden to work it and to keep it, and their work was fulfilling and life-giving and just living moment to moment. It was a pleasure to live. And sleep came easy, and it was refreshing. Oh, imagine what it was like to be in paradise. But then Satan came, tempted woman. Woman tempted man. They sinned. And then the curse came. We're told in the scriptures, the wages of sin is what? Death. It's a big word. It means more than just physical death. It's death in every possible sense. Death that affects their marriage. They never had any arguments before sin entered into the picture. Death that affected their children. They gave birth to two children, Cain and Abel. And then Cain got jealous of Abel's walk with the Lord. And Cain rose up and the first murder was infanticide. First murder ever to happen. And then life after life was given up. Death spread to all men for all have sinned. And you see conflict, you see war, you see all of the things reverberating to our very day. You see natural disasters, hurricanes, floods, pestilence, COVID, war and rumors of war. Everything in your life that you wrestle with, everything that's confusing to you, gender confusion that seems so rampant. I mean, imagine it. Back as a child, it was just such a bizarre thing to think that would be even a reality, that young people in middle school could not understand whether God made them to be a boy or a girl. And teachers telling kindergartners, you don't even have to make your mind up about that until you're several years older. It's such a bizarre time we live in. But every problem that we face in our world today, whether it's the crisis in Ukraine, or whether it's COVID, or whether it's your own personal struggles like Molly spoke of earlier, everything that's wrong on earth today finds its essence and its beginning in Eden. Everything that's wrong on earth today finds its essence in the beginning. And it's just echoed out throughout all time. But even there in the beginning, God made a promise. It was called by theologians the proto-evangel. He made a promise that one day the seed of the woman, the male descendant of the woman, would rise up and crush the serpent. And in doing so, he would find his heel bruised. Now, even there in the very beginning, the first whisper of hope, God gives himself. And God says, a day's coming when a son's going to be born. And don't you know, every male child that was born after that, they had to wonder, could this be the one? They had to wonder when they held baby Abel and baby Cain, maybe this will be short-lived. Maybe they will be the one. They had to wonder when they held baby Noah, when Methuselah held Noah for the first time, this grandchild, great-great-grandchild, as he held Noah in his arms and looked into his eyes, he had to wonder, could he be the one? And Noah seemed to have hope until he got off the boat. And then he got drunk and he did some awful things. And so every child born seemed to be an echo of hope. Even to this day, as we hear these children that cry out, they give hope to us that maybe a better day is coming. But generation after generation, Abraham was born. And it seemed as though he might be the one. God made a covenant with him in Ur of the Chaldees to depart and go to a land that he knew not of. God would show him the way, and he says, it's getting closer, but you're not there yet. It'll be through your lineage, through your descendant, that the whole earth will be blessed. And then David rose up as a man after God's own heart. He had the faith to slay the giant until he himself was slain by the giant of his own lust. And then man after man, generation after generation, war after war, depression after depression, heartbreak after heartbreak, until it was all broken by the cry of a baby in the little town of Bethlehem. The Lord Jesus comes onto the scene, the seed of the woman who would crush the head of the serpent and set all things right. He grows up at the age of 30. He begins his ministry, interestingly enough, by opening a scroll. He goes about and life flows out from him. And it seems like everywhere he goes, heaven follows. We're going to read more about that in just a moment. But here, we see in chapter 5, this scroll, and the scroll is the blueprint of God, the plan of God to make everything not just back to the way it was in Eden, but far better than it ever could have been in Eden. So that Satan not only loses, but he loses big, so that God flips the script on him. I know if you've been watching the way I have, it's hard not to admire this Ukrainian president as he's supplied, outmanned, but he's flipped the script on Putin and gotten the support of the whole world rallying around him. Well, in the same way, one day, it's what all seems like Satan is winning, and he's the prince of the power of the air, and he's won in the battle of good against evil. One day, God's going to flip the script on him. And the plan to do that is in this scroll. Marriage problems. There were no marriage problems before sin. The solution to every marriage problem ultimately is going to be found in this scroll. If you had financial problems, there were no financial problems before sin. But the solution to all lack is found in the unfolding of the scroll. Rebellion, disobedience, sickness, death, government problems, everything is going to be set right when that scroll is opened. Were you abused as a child? Have you been hurt by other people? Your justice is found in the opening of the scroll. Have you been falsely accused and attacked? Your vindication is found in the opening of the scroll. Setting right whatever is wrong will only happen if this scroll is open. Until then, you will not receive your full inheritance. Until then, death will win, families will fail, governments might as well shut down, but the hope is found in the scroll with seven seals. Verse 2, and I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals? So the question goes out, a summons as it were, who among you, like that great Arthurian legend, who can take the sword from the stone? Who might step up and take the scroll from the Ancient of Days and break its seals open? Who is worthy? Verse 3, and No one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to even look into it. Is there a man or a woman? Maybe in the Old Testament? Perhaps Moses, that delivered the people of God in a previous age, a man who spoke to God as a man speaks with his friend face to face, yet Moses keeps his silence. Perhaps Elijah or one of the prophets, but Elijah and the prophets sit silently. Maybe Solomon, the wisest man who ever lived in all of his great wisdom, but Solomon is silent. What of God's mighty angels, Michael, Gabriel? Could they, who are greater than man at this time, could they take the scroll and open its seven seals? But they stand silently. There was no one in all of heaven or in all of earth in any time who was able to approach Yahweh to take the scroll and to bring about the restoration of all things. And rightly so, in verse 4, John begins to weep. I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. Again, remember, this is the literal hope wrapped up in the scroll. This is not just that ethereal, mystical, spiritual hope, but this is a rock-solid hope. This is literally things being made right. You do understand that, don't you? In the culmination of all things, the promise is not that, well, it'll just all be okay. It'll be made right. He will make sure that justice does prevail, that everything that is hidden will be revealed. It's a promise, and it's not just a fuzzy promise. It's a solid hope and a solid promise. But not if no one can be found to open that scroll. And so the apostle weeps. He weeps because if that scroll is not open, everything he has suffered has been a colossal waste. There will be no resurrection. There will be no judgment. There will be no new heaven, no new earth. Satan wins. Death wins. The grave wins. Imagine a silent heaven. Not so much as the rustle of an angel's wing. And all of that silence is broken by the gasp and sobs and weeping and crying of the apostle. Verse 5. And one of the elders said to me, "Weep no more. The lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered." So he can open the scroll and its seven seals. And behold, the throne and the four living creatures, and among the elders I saw a lamb standing as though it had been slain, with seven horns and with seven eyes and with the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He has a fourfold description of Christ. He's called the Lion of the tribe of Judah. This speaks of his prominence. Judah was the tribe to which it was said, "The scepter will not depart from you." Judah is a lion's cub. "From the prey, my son, you have gone up." He stooped down. He crouched as a lion and as a lioness. Who dares rouse him? "The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet until tribute comes. And to him shall be the obedience of the people." That promise was found its fulfillment in the person that John was seeing, the lamb who was standing. Secondly, he's described as the root of David. That speaks of his propriety. In Isaiah 11, verse 10, it says, "In that day, the root of Jesse, who shall stand as a signal for the peoples, of him shall the nations inquire, and their resting place shall be glorious." In the genealogies of the Gospels, in both Matthew 1 and Luke 3, we see that Jesus, both from his father's side, his adoptive father, Joseph, and his physical mother, Mary, both trace their lineage back to the tribe of Judah and the person of King David. He was born, according to Romans 1:3, as the descendant of David according to the flesh. So he's the proper one to open the scroll. Third, he's described as a lamb. It speaks of his purpose. It's the word arnion in the Greek. It refers to a little lamb, a pet lamb. The imagery derives from the Passover, where the Jewish family was required to keep the sacrificial lamb as a house pet for 4 days prior to its sacrifice. In all of creation, no metaphor better describes the suffering Savior than that of a sacrificial lamb. He poured out his life for others. John saw him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But we read that he's not just a dead lamb, he's standing. That speaks of his prosperity. The scars from the deadly wound on the lamb are clearly visible, yet he's alive. Though demons and wicked men conspired against him to kill him, he rose from the dead, thus defeating and triumphing over his enemies. Now, put yourself in the place of John. You've heard the silence of heaven as no one was found to open the scroll. He's weeping. Those deep cries that you only feel a handful of times in life, thanks be unto God. He felt it like never before. All hope was gone until the elder said, "Don't weep, son." And then he sees Jesus, the one who is able, the one who can open the scroll. Interestingly, Jesus began his public ministry with the opening of the scroll, reading of the prophet Isaiah and saying, "These things have been fulfilled in your midst." He read the scroll and he went about from village and hamlet to city and town, and everywhere he went, it was like the kingdom of heaven just flowed through him. Everything that had gone wrong in Eden was made right when Jesus showed up. He taught the truth. Well, Eden, you had lies, but Jesus spoke the truth. You see Jesus preaching the gospel to the poor. You see Jesus opening blind eyes. You see Jesus letting the deaf hear, the lame walk. Jesus would speak to the hurricane, and it would set still like an obedient child. Jesus would take a little boy's sack lunch, and he would feed a multitude. Jesus would even speak to the dead. Probably one of the sweetest stories in the scripture is when a person had lost his little girl. There's nothing sadder in all of life's experience than to lose a child. But Jesus said, "Little girl, wake up." And life invaded her body at the word of Jesus. Everything that was wrong when Jesus showed up was made right. It was like heaven spilled over, but it only spilled over in a limited space and time in this little region about as big as from here to Orlando. This part of the globe there in the Middle East, they saw the kingdom at hand. That means you could literally reach out and touch it. And where Jesus showed up, heaven spilled over. And it all began with the opening of the scroll. Well, once again, we see as Jesus opens the scroll, all of the blueprint to not just fix a little marginalized Galilean village in the Middle East, but all of creation. To take everything that's wrong in your life, and those watching online, and those listening years after the fact, to fix everything. The one who can make it right and will make it right is the Lord Jesus Christ. And we see in verse 7, he went and he took the scroll from the right hand of him who was seated on the throne. And when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints, and they sang a new song. Notice the ancient practices mingled with modern creativity, something new and something old. Here in Florida, we take an annual, usually, sometimes more than once a year, pilgrimage to Orlando, to Disney World. One of the things that draws us, and most of us have to repent once we leave because it's not as much fun, it's not the happiest place on earth. I don't care what anybody says. But nevertheless, it keeps drawing us back. You would think we would learn, but just when we think we're out, they pull us back in again. And there we are. And the thing that always amazes me is how they can take Americana and the earliest days of our nation and portray it through the most cutting edge of modern technology. I love to see how they weave those two things together in a beautiful way. Well, here, as you see these, all of these people in the presence of Jesus, in the presence of God, you see both these ancient practices, the incense, the harps, but you see them also having their creativity unleashed. They write a new song, learn it, and sing it on the spot. A song never heard before in all of creation. You see, when you come into God's presence, it's not that it constrains you and binds you, it releases you. If you have anything creative about your nature, you will never find more freedom and creativity than you will in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. In verse 9, it says, they sang a new song saying, worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you have ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign upon the earth. Who are they? They are you. The Cherokee, the Chickasaw, the Mexican, the African, the Irish, the Russian, the Ukrainian, the Chinese, all of these people from all of these different ages that have trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, he's called them out, he's called them together, and he's redeemed them. Then I looked in verse 5, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders and the voice of many angels numbering myriads and myriads and thousands saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the sea and all that is within them saying, to him who sits upon the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshiped. Take that emotional journey with John. Suddenly caught up in a vision, he sees this amazing portrait of heaven. He sees the scroll. The scroll is the setting right of everything that's gone wrong. He can't wait to see that scroll opened. The call, the summons goes out into all of creation. Who can open it? Heaven's silent. And there for a moment, he falls into the deepest, darkest depression that anyone might ever imagine. He weeps until Jesus takes the scroll and all of heaven celebrates that now one has been found worthy to open the scroll. Now let's bring that back to where we are and what you brought into this building today. Maybe it's health problems. Maybe it's relational difficulties. Maybe that business you've dreamed of just hasn't gone as easy as you thought it would go. And you recognize and you realize the theological implications of the curse of the fall are leveled against you. And it seems like everything you do is just harder than it ought to be. And you yearn and you long for things to be made right. And you hear the promises of the scriptures that say they will be. What I want you to do today is to learn that here in the midst of all of this chaos that we read about earlier, that one is coming who will one day be able to take the sword from the stone. One who is coming who will be able to take the scroll from the hand of Jehovah. In 1922, Helen LaMille picked up a gospel tract by missionary Lilas Trotter. Lilas Trotter had served for more than 38 years as a missionary to the Muslims of Algeria. And this is an excerpt from that little tract. It was called, Which Passion Will Prevail? Trotter wrote, never has it been so easy to live in a half dozen harmless worlds at once, art, music, social science, gaming, motoring, and following some profession and so on. And between them, we run the risk of drifting about the good, hiding the best. It is easy to find out whether our lives are focused, and if so, where that focus lies. Where do your thoughts settle when consciousness comes back in the morning? Where do they swing back when the pressure is off during the day? Dare to have it out with God and ask Him to show you whether or not all is focused on Christ and His glory. Turn your soul's vision to Jesus and look at Him. A strange dimness will come over all that is apart from Him. Helen LaMille read that, and she wrote down the words to this hymn. O soul, are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see? There's light for a look at the Savior, and life more abundant and free. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace. Life is hard, and sometimes it feels like it's unbearable. But there's light for a look at the Savior. And if you will hear the Word of God today and get a glimpse of what John saw, the same hope that invaded the heart of the apostle will invade your heart. And yeah, you'll walk through this earth and you'll see nice cars. And you'll enjoy the things of earth. It's not bad in and of itself. It's okay to enjoy it. But somehow you'll know deep inside, this isn't what it's all about. There's so much more. There's life far more abundant and far more free. Why? Because I've seen the Lamb who can take the scroll, and He's going to make everything right one day. Let's bow our heads and pray together. With heads bowed and eyes closed, take a moment and focus on Him. When we preach the Word, when we sing the praises of Jesus, it does something. It's sort of like taking an instrument that's out of tune, and it turns the keys and it sets our heart in tune with the perfect. And suddenly what was disjointed and unpleasant, suddenly he tunes our souls to a melody that's beautiful. If you're here today and you haven't met Christ as your Savior, He wants to be more than your Savior. He wants to be your friend. He wants to be your boss. He wants to be your king. He wants to be your life. He wants to be your everything. And He's worthy. If He's worthy to approach the Ancient of Days and take the scroll of the unfolding of human history out of His hand, He's worthy to approach you and to take whatever you've got and to open it up and to make something beautiful out of your existence. In just a moment, our pastors are going to come. I'm going to pray a short prayer. When I say amen, if you're unsure where you stand with God, that's what we're here for, is to help you. And we would love to just pray with you and point you to Jesus and show you very simply how you can call upon the name of Jesus today and be saved. Perhaps you're here and you say, Pastor, I want to be a part of a tribe. You know, no human is an island. You just weren't created to function that way in isolation. That's what made COVID and the lockdown and all of that so difficult. We need each other. You need a tribe, you need a troop, you need a people. And if God has placed it on your heart that this is your tribe, this is your home, your family, your troop, then in just a moment, I want to invite you to come and say, I'd like to join the church, or our family would like to join. It would be our joy to receive you. Like we received several in the early service, why don't you come today and make this the day that you become part of us? Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, for your word. I can't imagine, Lord, life would be the sobs of John if there were no Jesus. I can't imagine closing up shop here today and saying, well, nobody was found worthy. So it'll be what it'll be. It'll be chaos until we all burn ourselves up. But thank you, Lord Jesus, that you were worthy, that you could take the scroll and you could break the seals. And Father, one day, new heavens and new earth will invade our current reality. And until then, we set our hope on you, and we ask you to give us the courage to do the next right thing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand and sing together.